Study Arata. Having a good memory is a competitive advantage that everyone wants to have. Being able to remember the correct answers for a test, or being able to answer any question from your boss without having to do any consultations, or remembering people's names and passwords and the greatest moments in your life. If you want to achieve all of that, it is crucial that you understand how your memory works. First, you need to understand how your brain records and stores and then retrieves information. And knowing all of this, you'll be able to use different techniques to carry out these procedures in a more efficient way. And these processes are relatively complex, and that is why I've created 4 special episodes here from this Study Arata series, so then you can understand in detail how your memory works. In today's conversation, we're gonna have an overview on how your memory works. And then in the next 3 episodes, we'll see in detail each one of the 3 specific procedures in the creation of memories. All set? So let's begin by remembering. Your memory works like a funnel that only stores the more important things. Let's recap what we've learned in the last episode of the Study Arata series, which was about the types of memory: sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. Sensory memory is linked to your 5 senses. Everything you see and hear and smell and feel, touch or taste stays in your memory for a very short period of time. It is so short, it stays up to just a few seconds. Every second, our brain is picking up thousands of stimuli through our 5 senses. It would not be possible to memorize everything that happens around us all the time. When our brain detects more relevant information, then the short-term or working memory comes into play. While your sensory memory is defined by the time it stores information in our minds, short-term memory is actually more connected to the quantity of the information that we're able to keep. And usually, the short-term memory is able to store around 7 units of information. For example, let's say someone tells you their phone number, but you have nothing to write it down with. So you keep repeating that number in your mind, so you won't forget it until you actually find something to write it down. And when you're repeating this number in your mind, maybe you're trying to move that information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory. Long-term memory is the part that stores information from a longer period of time. Now, it's important to explain here that when we say long-term, we're actually making a comparison with your sensory memory, which just lasts for a few seconds. That is why even a couple of days might be considered long-term in memorization terms. But depending on the relevance of the information, your memory might be even able to keep it for a few years in your mind. You can think about the 3 types of memory as if they were a filtered funnel. Everything that your 5 senses can pick up comes from the top of the funnel. And then in the middle of the funnel, there is a very limited amount of information that is being kept by your short-term memory. And just the most important information, the most relevant information, is able to pass this funnel and be sorted in your long-term memory. This transition of the information from short-term memory to long-term memory is called encoding. Encoding is moving information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory. Let's go back to the telephone number example. Someone told you a number, but you weren't able to write it down. You repeated the number so you wouldn't forget it until you find something to note it down. When you keep mechanically repeating something in order not to forget it, you're trying to send that information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory, and this process is called encoding. Anytime you're studying something or learning about something new, you are encoding new information in your long-term memory. Mechanically repeating something to store it in your memory is a very intuitive way of encoding, but it's not so efficient because your brain is not actively involved in the task. In order to store information so you can remember it in the future, you need to use techniques that actively involve your brain. One of these techniques is grouping. See, when you put similar information in the same category, you're using the grouping technique to encode that information. Another technique is using a mnemonic system. Every time you're using some little trick to remember whatever you're learning, you are using mnemonics. There are many different types of mnemonics. You could, for example, form sentences and acronyms and songs, mental images, anything that can help you to remember that information in the future. Self-reference is also a good encoding technique, and with that, you could use personal items to associate with what you're learning. And thanks to this personal involvement, it becomes easier to remember information in the future. And lastly, there's also a technique called spaced repetition. It is a way of organizing your study process, spacing your learning sessions through time in order to encode better. In the next Study Arata series episode, I'm going to be talking about each one of these encoding techniques. For the time being, you only need to understand that encoding is moving information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory. Once the encoding is done, your brain begins the storage process. Storage is the ability your brain has to store information from encoding to retrieval. Once the information is encoded in your long-term memory, it needs to stay stored until you want to use that information. And when you encode something, a memory trace is physically engraved in your nervous system. A memory trace is a physical change in your nervous system that represents an experience that you've had. And this memory trace is stored in your brain until you try to remember that information. The healthier your brain is, the easier it will be to store that information. Therefore, having a healthy life will positively influence your ability to remember things. Having a balanced diet, doing exercise, challenging your brain by learning new things, and having a good night of sleep are the most highly recommended activities to have a good memory. With a healthy brain, you can increase your retention period. The retention period is the time between the moment when you encode information and the time you try to use that information. And when we say we want to have a good memory, all we want is to have the ability to access these memory traces at the exact moment when we need them. And the last procedure is called retrieval. Retrieval is the ability to access memories whenever we need them. When you're taking a test and you need to know the right answer, you're using a retrieval process to remember the information that was encoded in your long-term memory. There are three ways to retrieve information from your memory: free recall, cued recall, and recognition. These three ways are in order here from the hardest to the easiest one. It is more difficult to recall information freely, and it is a little bit easier if you have some cues. And it's even easier if your job is just to recognize information. The hardest way of retrieval is free recall. Free recall is when you're trying to remember something without any type of help. And many times when we try to do that, we go blank, we forget what we were trying to recall. And to avoid that, your brain usually uses some clues that are left in the encoding process. For example, let's say that you used a mnemonic trick to encode information in your long-term memory. When you're trying to recall, you use the mnemonic trick as a clue to remember the encoded information, and this is a cued recall. The third and last way of retrieval is recognition. When you're using recognition, you remember something when you see that information among other data. This is like a comparison process. You compare with what you have in your mind and the things that you can see right now. The best recognition example are multiple choice questions. For example, let's say that you're taking a multiple choice exam about the Roman Empire, and then the question will be, who was the first Roman emperor? Options are Julius Caesar, August, Tiberius, and Caligula. The work your brain has to do is simply to compare what you've studied with the presented options and just recognize the correct answer. By the way, do you know the correct answer? If you said Julius Caesar, you're wrong. Your brain played you. Julius Caesar had an important role in the transformation of the Roman Republic into the Roman Empire, but the first emperor was August. You have probably studied this in school, so why were you not able to remember and recognize the correct answer now? This happens because our brain does not really work like a computer. We don't save information and recall it exactly as it was first recorded. Everything that happens from the time we encode information to the moment we try to retrieve it affects our memories. That is the reason why many specialists say that memories are not exactly retrieved, but they're rebuilt. You remember something? That memory always is rebuilt with some modifications. And these small changes depend on your emotional state, your humor, the references you've taken over time. Understanding how memory works is essential to increase your ability to learn. The ability to learn new things is the most important skill that you can have to improve your personal and your professional growth. And when you are here talking about learning new things, we're basically talking about being able to remember learned information whenever we need it. A student that is able to remember everything they've studied when they're taking an exam, or a professional that remembers every single procedure when their boss asks them a question, or an artist that is able to remember their references when they're creating art, or an athlete that remembers all the training that they had at the time of the game. That is why memorization is an important place when you are in a learning process. This is also why understanding the details about how your memory works is essential to learn more and better. In the next 3 episodes of the Study Arata series, we'll see in detail how each procedure of creating memories work: encoding, storage, retrieval. Today, you had an overview of how everything works, but there are still many more details to uncover. You're able to improve your memory, enhance your intelligence, and learn everything you want. In order to do that, you need to understand how your brain works and apply the right techniques to improve your cognitive abilities. Arata Academy is now launching a new course to help you learn all of this. You can check our intelligence course right now by clicking arata.se/intelligence.